one of their mobile kitchens and they actually...
is that even some, what I call habitual...
beautiful Stop and Shop in the Wilton... penalty, but it was actually a tax, and that it...
Good evening and welcome once again to the Marty Heiser Show, where you always get the truth. I'm your host, Marty Heiser. We are going to have an incredible show this evening. We're starting with really a hero. This man single-handedly won World War II. Hold on, Arthur, we're building it up. A fascinating story. And then the second half of the show, we are going to have a political roundtable discussion, including Chris Murray and Bob MacGuffie. They're on deck. But first, you know, Tom Brokaw wrote a book called The Greatest Generation. And what he was talking about, although Arthur is humble, is the man like Arthur Shilstone. He is an artist, a World War II veteran, and he has got an incredible story to tell about his life. And it begins when he was a 20-year-old art student at Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, New York, minding his own business, studying art, and then Hitler hauls off and invades Poland. Well, the next thing you know, you find him with his sketchbook in the foxholes on the Western Front following the D-Day invasion of Europe. But I'd just like to welcome Arthur Shilstone. Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
And you're an absolute gem, a much respected man from Reading, Connecticut. And I'm really appreciate Will bringing you in tonight.
Thank you for having me.
And we're joined too by Dave Strait, who is a bit of a historian himself.
Your loyal sidekick.
Loyal sidekick. We are so excited to have you. Now, just to sort of paint the story, you were part of an organization called the 23rd HQ Special Troops.
Right.
And for people that have watched war documentaries or saw the documentary Ghost Army.
Right.
Tell us what your mission was and what the thinking behind it was and what your experience was in the 23rd HQ Special Troops.
Well, our mission was to provide the Germans with misinformation. In other words, we had inflatable rubber tanks, trucks, guns, and we imitated the real units that we replaced. Okay. They would pull out and we would pull in with these things and inflate them. We also had sound players. They could broadcast sounds 15 miles away of tanks moving into position, trucks grinding. If the terrain were flat with bushes and so forth, there was that sound. If they were going over a wooden bridge, there was that sound. And also we had Signal Corps, which kept the same signals as the old company, only we adjusted it so that they would be phony.
Now, you worked hand in glove with the First Army,
right,
the Ninth Army,
right,
and what was made famous in the movie Patton's Third Army.
Yes, exactly.
That just absolutely raced across Europe after the beachhead was formed at D-Day,
right,
and went right up to the Rhine River.
Yeah.
You had to keep up with these folks.
Yes, we were.
And
the...
if you can hold up that one, this is one of your more famous illustrations. they're French citizens there, and they're amazed. What magazine did that appear in?
That appeared in Smithsonian Magazine.
Smithsonian Magazine. And they, these Frenchmen are over there looking, and they're noticing four soldiers picking up what looks like a Sherman tank.
Right.
And they are either incredibly strong Americans or...
Well, when I stopped them, they stopped. But they weren't looking at me. They were looking at something over my shoulder. And what they saw were four GIs picking up what would be a 40-ton Sherman tank, turning it around and putting it down. Actually, it was a 90-pound inflatable tank. They were looking at me and they were looking for answers, and I really didn't know what to say. So I said, the Americans are very strong.
So. Oh, that's great.
Iron Man.
Yeah. I'll tell you. Yeah, well, you know, I mean, frankly, the French, I mean, let's be honest here, we're among friends. We've had to bail out that country twice the last century. And what have we gotten? All we get with is attitude when you go over there and vacation.
Well, we just bail them out financially, too, so.
Yeah, I mean,
we're three for three.
Can we do enough for the French without the attitude?
Well, we were heroes when we went through the first time, but when you came back on pass, when you went to Paris, everything was changing.
Really?
Business as usual.
Business as usual.
Exactly.
Well, of course, when the Germans showed up, it was like, oh, right this way, yes, table for 80,000, right this way. It's Freetown, is it? Oh, so lovely to see you. It's terrible how that works. Okay, now, so you're in the foxholes working side by side with some incredible, I asked you just briefly, the Battle of the Bulge, where the lines had been formed, but I believe it was Rommel had an idea because they were short on fuel. They were going to pierce the line, and they call it the Battle of the Bulge because the lines actually bulged.
That's right, exactly.
And where were you, and what was your his
well,
role?
Well, we were in a village called Les Boules.
Okay.
And, well, apparently, I didn't know it, but we were a lot closer than I thought. And we got out. We just pulled out because, as I said, you don't kill many Germans with inflatable tanks.
I can see that, yeah.
We pulled back to Verdun.
Okay.
And we waited till the next assignment.
You didn't form a line of inflatable tanks and say,
No, not at all.
Take this.
But I remember it was unbelievably cold.
Really?
And those guys out in the holes, they were the real heroes.
Now, did you spend time in foxholes when
you
were there?
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
Is it true that the German foxholes were better constructed and furnished?
I don't know. I had to dig my own.
They were so happy when they would cross the enemy lines because then they got to get in. They got to inherit the Wilhelm's foxhole, and the Germans are very industrious.
They were indeed. All yeah. Right.
Now, while you're in these, you have some illustrations, and you call this your war drawings. You know, we think of Ernie Pyle; he's the famous war journalist.
Yeah, he was.
And I would say that some of these journals. Let's go through from left to right and tell us what we're looking at here and what you captured.
Well, this
and
is,
what you were using. I find that interesting.
I was using a fountain pen, and in order to get a wash, you know what a wash is.
Gray
color.
Yeah.
I'd just wet my thumb and get a little gray wash. If I wanted a black area like there, I would take the fountain pen and shake it, get a glob of ink, and then move it around with my thumb to get the black.
So you're not operating in a pristine, climate-controlled studio
with
all your...
these are the backs of envelopes and little cards and so forth that I found. So, but it was a visual diary, as I went through.
Right.
So starting on the boat going over, this was May 1944 in the North Atlantic, and it was very cold and windy. And so these are just two guys talking.
Huddled together.
And wearing May West vests.
Okay.
Tapes. Like this.
Yeah. Mae West, of course, a well-endowed actress of the
Universal.
Hey, come on, these guys were saving the world. They didn't have time to be politically
correct.
That was
before Apple.
Before. All right, so let's keep moving through these. So we had next.
Well, it's another one, same thing. You can keep moving along.
All right, now is it true when they were coming over, you came over on the boats right after D-Day? Is that how you were transported to the continent?
Yeah.
All right.
There's something showing.
Was the weather so bad like that?
Or it was pretty rough.
And so you got to a point where you were just dying to get on the beach, even if it was all hell was breaking loose.
I was dying to... get out of England, because when we were, you'll see something here, when we were at one of their, you can bring it along a little bit.
Yeah, keep going to the right,
There, that was an English mess hall, English mess.
Okay.
And the food was absolutely atrocious, but there were rats all over the place.
Is that right?
We were sleeping on the ground, and as soon as it started to get dark, they came out.
Ooh.
And they were running all over us and squeaking, and one guy fell asleep and woke up with them chewing on his fingers. So anyway, I was glad to get out of there and get over to Normandy where it was at least clean.
You were being shot at, but at least you didn't have to deal with the rats. So that was a Quonset hut. So so let's just review. English, not very good on the culinary arts. Maybe the French were a little better, but they just are constantly losing wars without us. So I don't know.
toss up.
You can either live in freedom and eat bad or be conquered and have very good soup. Okay, so what do we have next there?
Oh, this is my home at the front. Okay. We replaced a an artillery unit, and that was already dug and so on and so forth. The Germans are in the at the last line of trees. Uh-huh. And this was a very kind of good home for me, actually.
And that was a big part of it was trying to forge out some creature comforts when you're out there in the dead of winter,
right.
A little warmth, a little something.
Yeah. This was November. It was starting to get very cold.
Wow.
Had a tin can with a stovepipe and a little fire in it and some straw in there, and it was...
Now, if you watch the series, The Band of Brothers and things like that, do you sense that captures it?
Yes. Oh, well, they had it much worse than we did. I mean, we were very lucky. If we had been found out, according to reports that came out later, our casualties would have been 85%.
Wow.
As it was very light. Yeah. We had a few guys killed. So,
Well, it's incredible. I mean, the strategic value. How many inflatable tanks would you guys deploy?
Well, I think on the Rhine there were hundreds. I'm not sure.
Right.
But, you know, you're just a small part. You don't know what the rest of the outfit is doing or where they are.
I mean, when these commanders, when Eisenhower needed a division, there weren't any available. Let's put out the inflatable tanks and you get the benefit of it. Okay, next we have...
That's just a friend of mine. Chuck Tribble. We were waiting to come home, and so I just did a picture of him.
All right, and then the next one is...
Just there's always a card game going on. This is in Verdun.
Uh-huh. No gambling.
A little bit.
I'm shocked. You ever seen that scene from Casablanca where they come in and say, gambling? Later on, we have a political roundtable. That's where we sense that, you know, some in the present administration are saying when they say, they're targeting conservatives? I'm shocked. But anyways, rolling ahead.
Yeah. And this is Normandy. That's a, there was a sniper in that cupola.
Is that right?
And they got him out before we arrived.
Wow.
He was either going to continue shooting or they're going to blow the top off, and he decided to come out. And that's Treviere. That's in Normandy. But all the towns look like that. They were just blasted. Just blasted. And
when a guy gave himself up, how was he treated?
Depends. I think in the early days when the paratroopers caught them, they probably shot them, but you know, because they couldn't keep them. They had to keep moving. But they were treated pretty well, I guess.
They didn't get sent to Gitmo, huh?
No, actually, during World War II, there was so much transport coming over from the United States into the European theater that there was plenty of transports to go back. And there's stories of captured German soldiers that went and worked on potato farms for a German farmer in the middle of Pennsylvania and had the best apple strudel you could imagine. I mean, seriously, that's where the POWs, they got fat on apple strudel in Pennsylvania if they surrendered to you and your inflatable tanks.
I'm trying
to paint a picture here.
Yeah, well, I know we had to guard some Italian prisoners.
Yeah.
And they
were
very happy.
Oh, they were happy.
With us. Yeah.
Oh, viva America!
You need to get them to cook for you.
Viva America! Fui on Mussolini. Okay, and then the last one there?
Well, this is landing at in Normandy. And we were anchored off the coast, waiting to go ashore. And I looked out and I saw this incredible scene. I mean, boats as far as you could possibly see.
You were there the day of D-Day.
No, this is D-18.
Okay.
But
it was still they were still coming in there.
Oh my God! The balloons, their barrage balloons, were attached to ships below by heavy cable. The reason for that was that the Germans couldn't come low below bombing or strafing the. So that's what that is.
Just incredible.
But after this, my name was called, and they go over the side on the cargo nets into the boats.
Just incredible. You know, I mean, it's such a blessing to have you here, just sharing these stories.
Well,
because you're the greatest generation, and I know you poo-poo that, but I'm telling you, it was very much in doubt as to who was going to win that war.
Absolutely.
Marty, I've talked to a number of World War II people, and they have one thing in common. The word I doesn't exist. Huh. They never use the word I. You know what I mean? It's the most humble generation, too. In fact, remember the raising the flag at Iwo Jima? Yeah. That memorial?
Yeah.
The guys that were doing it, one of the guys' kids, grandkids, didn't even know his grandfather was involved in that until he passed away, because he never talked about it. And then he found in his closet a box of that information.
Wow. Well, I think the guys who really had the heavy stuff, I mean, it was just too gruesome to even recall.
Yeah.
So they didn't talk about it.
Nowadays they call it post-traumatic stress disorder. You know, back then it was a bit of shell shock, a bit of, you know, he saw some stuff in the war.
Shell shock was World War I, I think.
Okay.
And then, what was it in World War II? Something, I don't know, but it's still the same.
Same thing.
Yeah, it's the same
thing. But it is common. I mean, when I've read a little bit about some of the soldiers returning now, they had, you know, PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, they have it now, but it echoes what other soldiers have experienced through the years.
I think it's almost worse today because there's no rear lines.
Yeah.
And you can go out in the truck and get blown up just going to the someplace.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's worse today in that sense. There's constant tension.
Yeah.
Was there ever a period during World War II where it felt from the American side like we might not win this one? Or that never crossed anybody's mind?
I'm sure it
crossed. Battle of the Bulge?
No, I think they. I don't think. That was the biggest battle of World War II in Europe, but that wasn't going to go anywhere really.
Okay.
But I'm sure Eisenhower had big doubts in the beginning. He must have.
They were definitely sweating because they called off D-Day for one or two days because of weather, and then they finally gave the green light. And let's just say he was smoking a lot of cigarettes.
Imagine the responsibility of that. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
God.
Yeah. Okay, so you obviously, by all appearances, made it through the war, because here you are in our studio. And then you come out and you start your career as a magazine illustrator. Mm-hmm. Your works appeared in Life magazine, Sports Illustrated, New York Times. These are some fly-by-night publications you maybe never have heard of before. And the Smithsonian, and you went on to be one of the key illustrators for none other than NASA. We have some of your work here. We're just going to roll through it quick.
Which do you want to see first?
I want to see the one right there, that Secret Moments.
Oh, this was Life magazine.
We're going to roll through them real quick, yeah.
What this was Kennedy's campaign.
Right.
So they said, we want a picture of Kennedy in a pensive move in the back of his plane.
Okay.
We want some of his staff members, and we want to see the inside of the plane and the outside of the plane flying over a storm in the Rockies. We'll give you 5 days.
There you go.
So I didn't have a picture of Kennedy like that. So my wife took a picture of me, then I found other pictures of Kennedy, and I ended up with what I think was a pretty good
likeness. That's a pretty hard bill to fill.
Minus his girlfriends. No girlfriends in the picture, right?
No girlfriends.
All right, so let's keep
going. And I worked for Life for 12 years.
All right.
And I did their murder trial, starting with the Shepard murder case. You did probably Shepard murder case. And this
happened. That was
That was the O.J. Simpson trial of its day. This is a guy in the Korean War who was a traitor. He sided with the Koreans and killed Americans and so forth. And this was a drawing that I did in court. It was a pencil drawing. And then when I got back to my hotel room, I did it in ink. So that was that.
Should we go to NASA?
No, you want to see more illustrations?
Yeah, we want to see because there's hunting and
This is a thing for
Smithsonian.
That's the cover.
Wow.
This was Benedict Arnold's raid on Quebec, which was a
and
big
then this
failure.
One too?
No, that's something else.
Okay.
And by the way, Benedict Arnold, he's got a lot of bad press, but early on in the Revolutionary War, he was great.
True hero.
Do you know in the Battle of Ridgefield, he had three horses shot out from underneath him? And the last horse had 8 mini balls in him. I mean, he was in the thick of things.
Well, Saratoga was the one. He really won that up there. Yeah.
So what's the moral of the story? You got to finish well. You know, you turn over and your name is equivalent with the traitor.
He did go to the British side for a pretty big sum of money, I think. And he was married to a Tory.
Yeah, and she was a little wacky. And then they turned over the plans of West Point, right?
Yeah, right.
It's not a good thing. Anyways, okay. We're in the lightning round. We're going to go through the next six real quick.
Civil War story, just Confederates defending the position.
Okay, you had one with the Buffalo soldiers. Appear in?
Right there.
Uh-huh. Is this one of yours? Sorry.
Yeah.
Here we go.
You know who the Buffalo soldiers were?
Yeah, they're African American soldiers that fought bravely.
Very good.
Absolutely.
You're a natural historian on this stuff, Marty.
I make it up as I go along.
Okay.
Pictures help.
Yeah, so this was part of a long story that I did for them.
And then some of your sports, you have some in Sports Illustrated?
Yeah.
Is it in the magazine or the front?
Yeah, no,
or
what? It's the magazine. This one, try this one under there.
There we go. Got it.
This was Stingley and Tatum. Do you remember that?
Is that where he killed the guy?
Paralyzed him.
Okay. And that's the shot. They described it, and that's the way I drew
it. Jack Tatum.
And they're both dead now, as a matter of fact.
Wow.
But then you look at the next one, sports.
But can you make a pretty good buck when your illustrations appear in some of these magazines?
Yeah.
Now, do you get residuals on that or anything like that?
No.
But you made a good living at this.
It's good enough.
All right. You were married 60 years.
Yeah.
Had two sons.
Right.
Five grandsons.
Yes.
Wow. Interesting.
This is...
Dave's going to hold up this one.
Okay. Uh-huh.
This is what he ended up as.
Okay. That was actor Jack Tatum. Hit him.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
That was the guy who resulted.
See that? Quadriplegic.
Wow. Excellent. Well, listen, your work is beautiful.
Thank you.
Your life story is absolutely, incredible. I know
you
downplay it, but, I mean, the fact that you played a role in defeating Nazism during the Great World War II is impressive.
You're telling me something I don't know.
Well, I'm telling you, it is impressive, and we are honored to have you on the
pleasure.
Show.
Can we
get you to come back with maybe another World War II veteran?
Sure.
Around Memorial Day? I mean,
love to have it.
You have to try to find one who's alive.
Well, listen, from the looks of you, you got another 40, 50 years kicking just fine.
I'm 90 years old.
90 years old?
90 years old.
You look remarkably well.
Yeah, well, thanks. Tell my bones that.
I'm telling you, you're getting around great. Well, listen, thank you so much for coming in.
Okay, my pleasure.
Will, I want to thank you for bringing your friend in and an absolute patriarch from Reading, Connecticut.
There's something for NASA.
All right, we're gonna close with this shot. This is a shot from NASA. And there's some crazy guy sitting under a rocket with a sketch pad. Can you tell us who that person is? Is that you?
I had 7 assignments for NASA.
Okay.
I was one of 8 artists chosen to paint the original maiden voyage.
Okay.
Yeah. They sent us down there, and we had 3 days to go around and paint and so forth, and then gave them a painting each time. So,
Well, listen, thank you so much again.
Okay.
I really appreciate
gentlemen.
It. And we absolutely are going to demand that you come back.
Okay.
Well, I'll tell you, it's interesting because we've had a hero, someone who's been on, it'd be good if we're over here, it'd be a hero from World War II, and I'm looking for the tight shot over here. We could do that. Basically, Arthur, there we go. We had someone who was involved with defending our freedoms, our liberties, and unfortunately, recently, if you're watching the news, you've seen some of those liberties begin to slip away. It just keeps coming. Today we had reports that basically you got Verizon, I got Verizon. They're a pretty good network. Apparently every single phone call you made is now being recorded and the government has that information. But don't worry, it's going to be fine. They won't use that for any nefarious reason. I'm sure it's going to be just fine because it's nothing like, say, the IRS, where they take your information and they give it to other people, donors lists, or they target you because of your political persuasion. That stuff never happens. We're going to go to a video right now about the IRS, and then we're going to come back with Bob MacGuffie, who heads up the Tea Party here in Connecticut. Chris Murray, a Ridgefield resident, has had some incredible insight and has an online webpage as well. And we're going to talk about some of the things that are going on in our nation's capital that are affecting you. But first, watch this video about the IRS and tell you if it doesn't put a chill down your spine. Let's go to the video.
Dr. Kenny, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. John Adams knew that facts are stubborn things. In this district, facts are hidden under the mantle of office. They get used as tools or weapons, but they wait for us. We must seek them with the lamp of truth and put them into words. But you and I speak different languages in this republic. You speak the language of power, of pen, purse, and gavel. I speak American grassroots, the language of liberty, through providence, property, and civic virtue. We seldom speak together about the rule of law unless it is ignored or violated. Now is such a time. I have a story that bridges the distance between my state of California and this capital. What I say here must be said here. Pilgrims brought to this continent a lamp of liberty, guided here by the pursuit of life within the words of Moses and Christ. They persevered for righteous freedom. We sit here in the shadows of Washington, Jefferson, and Lincoln. We visit here memorials to those who failed in service to this country. They persevered for righteous power. The spirit of patriots living and dead grants me the right to be here. It is my duty as an American citizen to speak here today. In October 2010, the San Fernando Valley Patriots, a not-for-profit corporation in California, applied with the Internal Revenue Service for a 501c4 status as a tax-exempt social welfare organization. We were then and remain a Tea Party group affiliated with the National Tea Party Patriots. We heard nothing until February 2012, when I received a packet from the IRS Exempt Organizations Office in Cincinnati, Ohio, which included a questionnaire with 35 items divided into 80 subpoints of inquiry. A cover letter indicated that we had 20 days to comply without penalty, including penalties of perjury, for failure to answer all questions with facts that are true, correct, and complete. Generally, the questions were a demand that read like the chilling words from the 1950s, "Are you now or have you ever been?" The IRS sought documentation of our meetings, rallies, events, or candidate forums. That included video and audio transcriptions, notes, copies of all handouts, the political parties of speakers, and an issues list. The IRS sought identifying information on employees, data on volunteers and members, plus employer identification numbers on businesses with which we associate. These are our donors. They have names. Mike, the printer, who gave us a discount on handbills. Dee, the beauty consultant, who donated posters for our tax day rallies. And Greg, the electrician, who made a stand for our 9/11 banner out of pipes and wires. The IRS sought EINs and details on our Association of Tax-Exempt Organizations. These are our teachers. They have names. The Heritage Foundation, Freedom Works, and the National Center for Constitutional Studies, where we learn American history. The Tea Party Patriots, where we learn grassroots skills. And the West Valley Food Pantry, our charity. The IRS sought details of communications with our legislators. Even in Southern California, that is protected free speech. My personal favorite was question number 33, which in relation to protests asked for a listing of our, quote, committed violations of local ordinances, breaches of public order, or arrests, then requested details on how we conduct or promote illegal activities. I think the IRS needs to fix its labeling machine. We're the San Fernando Valley Patriots, not Occupy Oakland. I stopped the costly and exhausting IRS process in July 2012. We survive on my credit card and donations in our cake tin. Like patriots before us, we persevere. The voice of the Republic resides in our citizens, not in the tongue of government. More must grasp that self-evident truth. This dialogue is about the jackboot of tyranny upon the field of our founding documents. To whisper the letters IRS strikes a shrill note on Main Street, USA. But when this behemoth tramples upon America's grassroots, few hear the snapping sounds. Now more people listen, but few who know the truth speak. This moment reflects a reality of governance in America. This time we came to you, In time, you will come home to us. This time we came for truth. In time, the lies will fall. Vox populi, vox dei, the voice of the people is the voice of God, is irresistible but different in America. Our voice belongs to the free individual, not to the collective mob. Our voice is best heard when power kneels, then whispers to liberty's strength. And when liberty stands under heaven and shouts to power, freedom. Thank you.
Well, I'll tell you, that's anyone's Aunt B. You know, the federal government, the full weight of the federal government is coming down on people because of their political expression. I mean, is this some sort of pathetic banana republic where the tin horn dictator's in charge and takes out anyone that disagrees with them? Is that what Arthur and the Greatest Generation went and fought over in Europe for? I thought we had the freedom of expression. I thought this was America, where you had the right to express your political views without fear of being oppressed by a federal government coming down. I mean, what the hell is going on here? This is unbelievable. And if you're not outraged, you're just not paying attention. It's our generation that this stuff is happening in. And we have to transfer our generation to the next generation. And are we going to transfer that with the freedoms intact that we had? God knows we've screwed up the economy, and we're going to label the next generation, these young people in the studio right now, with debt you can't even believe. And why? Because we can't get it together enough to control our spending. So what the hell? Put it on the credit card. Let the next generation pay for it. And guess what? When Obamacare starts kicking in and you got all these college kids coming out of school that can't find a goddang job because there's all this oppression from the federal government, all these mandates, and then they're going to go, oh, hey, guess what, recent college graduate? We're going to need about $2,000 a month for your health care. Oh, yeah, I know. You guys are real healthy. You don't really need it. But you gotta pay. And guess what? If you don't pay, we're gonna take it out of your federal tax return. Guess why? Because we're the liberal Democrats and we're in charge and we don't give a damn about anything. We don't give a damn about the freedom of the press. We don't care if someone, you know, is saying something against us. We're gonna go after them and we're gonna go after their parents' phone records out on Staten Island. Are you kidding me? Their parents' phone records? And then I gotta come home from work after working all day and see a guy in a goddang Spock outfit from Star Wars who paid $60 million for a Star Wars little tableau at one of their IRS conventions. And then this moron is in front of Congress. And even the Democratic congressman has to say, what the hell were you thinking? This is the government that we have right now. And I don't care if you're liberal or conservative or Republican or Democrat, but ask yourself, is this the best we can do? Are you kidding me? We have a caller on the air. Caller, if you're still there and I haven't blown your eardrums out, what's on your mind?
Marty, a couple things. First of all, love the passion. Love the way you go after the liberal Democrats. And more of a question regarding Holder. When do we see Holder taken out? When is he going to be taken out? When is he going to be resigned? When is he going to resign? What's it going to take to knock
Listen,
him out?
Listen, we had on this show last week, I mean, this is just a joke. The guy comes before Congress. When you raise your hand and swear, that's called sworn testimony. When you lie in sworn testimony, that's called perjury. You're not supposed to be able to do that. And this guy comes out there and says, swears he had nothing to do with targeting anyone. He had nothing to do with anything having to do with pursuing journalists. Nothing whatsoever. Guess what? His signatures on subpoenas. Signatures. I mean, there's no doubt he was involved, and he swore he wasn't. He's lying. It's just lies. So that's how I feel about it. I don't know. How do you feel about it?
As far as I'm concerned, it's time to go. Dave?
Listen. When you got the president coming out saying, I wholly support fill in the blank, that person, fill in the blank, should start bumping up his resume because he's about to lose his job. Listen, thank you for the call. I appreciate it.
You bet, Marty.
All right, listen, I'm sorry. I almost feel like apologizing. I get a little wound up here, but my psychiatrist says it's a good way for me to vent. It's a good thing because otherwise it builds up and the agita, you just got to let it go. Bob MacGuffie. You're like the grand poobah of the Tea Party or whatever. Frankly, I think you're a little bit nuts. But then I find out that
after
you're...
After that?
Yeah, yeah. Pod
you and I don't remember.
I'm telling you, I can't take it anymore. I'm not as old as I can take it anymore. Okay, that's it. Only decaf from now on. Listen, thank you so much for coming in. I'm sorry to take up all the air in the room. We're also joined by Dave Strait, who's just a really wealthy guy with a lot of ideas, and he... downloads a lot of stuff.
Don't say that. The IRS is going to come back. Yeah, okay?
We're all screwed. I'm going down fighting. That's all I'm doing. And we got Chris Murray, who puts out the publication called...
The Fairfield County Patriot.
Patriot. Patriot. Bola. Bola. Be on the lookout. Be on the lookout. Patriot. You want to flag that? Audit the guy. Patriot. Oh, he's in favor of the Constitution. Oh, God, Patriot. Oh, he'll target him. Target him. Okay, sorry.
We wouldn't even let you in at TV.
I know. Okay.
We'd ask you to leave.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. Let's all deep cleansing breath through the nose. Out through the mouth.
You want to do the MSNBC?
No. I want to talk to Bob MacGuffie. Right. Bob, tell me what's going on. Do I got any of this wrong?
No, you got it right.
What's the latest?
We've known all along, and the government reaches out in it's got tentacles everywhere. There's people that have been harassed through OSHA. There are patriot groups that are being harassed through the EPA now, which is going to come up, and you'll be hearing about that. The IRS situation, and they're squeezing the toothpaste from the right end of the tube, and they're going to work up, and they're going to get the big guys. Because if you proceed from the logical assumption that this has been directed from the West Wing, they're going to get there. So, if the congressional committees go at it appropriately, they'll get there.
Is a special prosecutor a good idea or a bad idea?
Well, no, it's a good idea. That would give them more authority than a congressional committee. But I think on the Benghazi side, you need a select committee. Once they do a select committee, they'll sit there for months, and they'll bring people back and get corroborating testimony and then ask for more, and that's what you want to see. On the IRS, you want to see a special prosecutor go after it. Because these congressional hearings that we see, five-minute question from either side, they can dodge through that, and some of them have. But
these all have subpoena power, and you perjure yourself if you don't.
The select committee would, yeah. Okay. Yeah, absolutely.
And they also have the power to grant immunity, so you
can
trade off.
That's the thing. So if they have a tougher time going up the ladder and they want to grant the immunity, they do that. And if you watched Watergate, that's exactly how they worked it right on up. Right.
What's the latest? I mean, as it seems to be encroaching closer and closer to... Essentially, I think the White House, at the very least, if not the Oval Office. I mean, it's almost comical. We run that video from Casablanca where the guy walks in and goes, you know, gambling? There's gambling here? I'm outraged. And, I think the Obama administration, they are targeting Tea Party members? I'm outraged. I mean, it's just,
They're going to trace this right into the West Wing. There's absolutely no doubt about it. They already have an attorney who has given the instructions to the people.
You know what I love? They insist that this targeting wasn't political. It was not political. And then the IRS commissioner comes in. Well, who gave the orders to do this? We don't know. Well, who was the one that told? Was it just the low level people in Cincinnati? Oh, well, we don't know. Well, who gave the orders? Well, we're not. No one really knows. Yeah. But we do know it wasn't political. That we know. We know whoever said to do it, it wasn't political. But we don't know right now. We're looking into it. Who did it? But we know it's not political.
I thought
give me a
break. They already cleaned house, right? Because Obama fired the guy that was.
going to retire in 2 weeks anyway, and he kicked out two guys that got a free meal. So didn't that take care of it?
Yeah.
They think so. I mean, if you want to be able to decode all of this, just read George Orwell's book 1984, and you'll see the whole thing. Yeah. Newspeak and, you know, 2 Minutes Hate and all the rest of it. It's, you know, all in there.
When the Tea Party formed in 2009, we said, we were accused of being radicals, and we said, no, it's our government that is radical. I don't think any of us could have anticipated that it was this bad and that it was this widespread. The solution may be only political with respect to Obama, you know, and Holder, and, you know, ushering these people out of power by hook or by crook. But we have a kind of a fundamental problem with Washington. And what's been proven by all this is that our claim that government is too big is proven by all these actions, this willful intimidation by organs of government. Mm-hmm. It's too big, it's out of control, it's self-serving, and we're paying for it.
Well, and there are no consequences.
Right.
No consequences whatsoever.
Permanent bureaucracy, and they have their own self-interest in mind, and they know how to protect themselves and to keep expanding their role and justifying themselves. They do it decade after decade.
In the last 5 years since Obama's been president, it now costs an average household $15,000 a year in government regulations. That's up 20% in 5 years.
Yeah. Well, at some point, you know, it's going to become unaffordable.
It
has to be. It's already unaffordable to most.
They're after the small businessman, because that equals liberty for the average guy. And there's a lot of, you know, private property, liberty, small business. They don't want small business people, so they put regulations on them, licensing on them, restrictions on their products they can sell and all the rest. And it just grinds the average guy down, and that's the objective.
You know where how it translates to? I think one of you guys sent me a graph that shows the number of entrepreneurs declining precipitously.
Yeah.
Do you know where else it shows up as a data point? Birth rates.
Yeah.
And we're seeing that in Ridgefield.
They call it family formation.
Right. I mean, people are discouraged. I talk to young mothers. I mean, I'm on the board of ed. I talk to young mothers, and they look at me and they say, I can't afford to have another child to send them to college.
Yeah.
I can't afford it. Well, what a tragedy that is.
It really is. I mean, the whole concept of you know, the American dream. You can go out and you can make something of yourself. You know, the kind of a rewarding and celebrating success. Herschel Alger's, you know, we love that American dream. That's taken somehow accomplishment. The accumulation of wealth is held in disregard, and it's suspect, and it needs to be taken because, you know, if he has more, then the rest of us don't have enough. And instead of wanting to bake a bigger pie, I mean, Abraham Lincoln said, you cannot lift up the wage earner by tearing down the wage payer. And I think this government, and it comes from the top, and this anti-freedom, anti-free enterprise, mm-hmm. anti-business, pulling the Apple guy in front of them and saying, hey, you owe us, you know, more in taxes. Apple. I mean, how much have they enhanced our life with the products that they have? And yet they're going after their profits, anything. And
not a surprise to us, but that the fact that it's coming out in the first year of his second term is a little surprising. That it's full blown now, and every day is something else. And today, of course, we all woke up to find out that the government and Verizon are colluding to capture 120 million phone numbers and everything that those folks are doing, and they're just capturing it there. They're building a big data center out in Utah, and I've seen pictures of it and write-ups on it. To capture all this data, is something like 10 trillion gigabytes going to be out there, mm-hmm. and they're going to run every phone conversation, everything else through there, and do all that tallying they're talking about.
Here's the thing. When this whole thing with the Verizon thing came out, and listen, all you got to do is turn on the news every night, and then this guy
Today's
in the
news.
Spock costume. I can't get that out of my head. What the? This is the assistant, you know, head of the IRS. The line dancing. I mean, it's just
stuff.
Ridiculous. But the thing of it is, you know, normally, you're like, all right, well, you know, the government is keeping tabs on some of these phone lines. You know, there's terrorism we got to keep an eye out for and stuff like that. No big deal. But when you couple that with what's happened at the IRS, mm-hmm. where the government has taken that information and used it to target people that disagree with them politically, that's where it becomes insidious.
But hold it, they did that in Russia.
Yeah, sure they did.
They do it all over the world, but that's the unique thing about...
They do it in China, so why can't we do it here?
Well, any consolation you gotta put sorry. I don't take any consolation in the explanation, shall we say,
that they're not monitoring individual phone calls, because they absolutely have that ability.
You know...
And it's only it's a short step for these folks. You know, the weight of, you know, going from taping these or knowing where these phone calls are starting and ending to actually listening to them, the baggage is very light for these people, these liberals in power. The ends justify the means. It's as simple as that.
Yeah, we're the good people. We want to do good things for people. So it's good for anything that we need to do. I mean, that guy McDermott, when those people that were giving their testimonies before Congress, and he says, hey, you guys came out against abortion, and you guys came out against the Obamacare. You know, why shouldn't you, be targeted? You know, you're very political. As if, shut the hell up and take it.
Yeah.
Don't you be the whack-a-mole that raises his head and dares to express himself politically, because you'll pay the price. That's McDermott.
It took a UK newspaper, The Guardian, which by the way, this is an interesting kind of permutation on this. Guardian is a liberal newspaper. It took their reporter, Glenn Greenwald, to come up with this story.
Yeah.
And the point I'm making is that the Department of Justice is now investigating Greenwald. They're going after this British reporter.
Of course.
And his response is, bring it on.
Yeah.
So my point is, I think that even the liberals are sensing now what's going on.
I mean, when you have Chris Matthews say, when I'm around Barack Obama, I get this chill up my leg. And he's going to be the one that's going to, be an aggressive. Anyways, we are joined by a sane voice. State Representative Dan Carter is on the phone. Representative, I know you've been up there. Just for the vast viewing audience here, how late did you guys work into the session? I mean, in any given day, what was the record late night you worked in Hartford?
this year the record late night was, I think, about 5:30 in the morning on a session where we had started about 10:30 or 11 the day before.
So you start at 10:30, 11, in the morning? 10:30 in the morning?
Yeah, usually, we're on legislator time.
Right.
They'll schedule the session for 10:30. We'll really get rolling about 11:30. And then oftentimes what will happen is they'll bring out some big bills after the press has gone home.
Jeez.
You will
sit there and work until 5:30 in the morning, actually seeing the sun rise over the state capitol.
Yeah, it's actually an uncomfortable feeling when you're walking out the door and you hear the birds chirping.
Now, is it true, as a state representative, if you were paid by the hour, you could make more money at McDonald's? Can you confirm that?
I could definitely confirm that.
And I hear at McDonald's, the apple pies, if they're out over a certain period of time, the employees are allowed to eat them. Don't ask me how I know that. All right, listen, Dan, first of all, thank you for all your public service. And I don't think many people know, I get tweets from people and Facebook postings, and they're coming in at like 4 in the morning. I'm like, these guys need to get, a real job. This is incredible. But thank you very much for your efforts. And what's the latest? And I know the panel has a few questions for you, but give us what's the latest.
Well, the latest is, Marty, we finished up the session last night at midnight. And we're bound by the Constitution to finish at midnight this Wednesday. So we did that, and of course afterwards there's a joint session which ends at about 1:30 in the morning or so, and then that's it. So we're all going back to our respective day jobs. Good or bad news, we passed the budget. I would say good news, we're done. Bad news, it's a $44 billion budget.
Wow.
Among other really nasty things we passed this year, but yeah, I'm sure the panel will have some questions regarding that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, so Dan, one of the things was there was a vote on how much of the information regarding the Sandy Hook shooting should be released. How'd that go?
Well, the basically, the way this thing rolled out is, you know, in the beginning, it was Newtown, and the events of Newtown that was the catalyst, because there was a lot of pressure from the families that we really should be restricting the photographs and also the audio tapes of the 911 call, you know, because of what it would do, you know, long-term for the families, coming back every year, the sensationalism. So as this thing kind of moved along, a number of things happened. First, the Black and Latino caucus got involved, and rightfully so. They saw this as a more broader issue, that oftentimes, you know, who really cares about, you know, what happens in Hartford or New Haven or other places? Why should the folks in Newtown be treated any differently? So as this whole thing evolved again, we found that in federal law, the Supreme Court has upheld the fact that some things can be an unwarranted invasion of privacy. That came from the Vince Foster case, if you recall.
Yeah.
A lot of people didn't believe Vince Foster had actually committed suicide, and there were folks who were actually looking for the photos.
Wow.
And so as this kind of grew, it's been very controversial. It did pass a couple nights ago, and they restricted the... basically, what it'll be is any photo of anybody in a homicide, so a victim of a homicide, can be withheld. It's what the final thing was. And only photos, audio, film of the body of the person.
Wow.
All the other crime scene photos are fair game. And with respect to the audio tape of 911, anything where it's referring to the victim in graphic ways, it's transcripted.
We're joined as well by Bob MacGuffie. He has a quick question for you, and then we'll let you get home and get some sleep.
Dan, in getting to final budget, I know there had to be some games played. Where did Malloy ultimately get the money from? As I understand it, they're not going to contribute to the pensions. They continue to reduce the contributions to the pensions. We know where that leads. Is that the plug?
I couldn't get that last part. Did you say, is that the plus or the plug?
No, the
is that
plug.
Is that the plug in the budget by reducing the contribution to the state workers' pensions?
Well, that's part of it. I mean, part of it's how they redesigned the constitutional spending cap, which is one of the big deals, because the way it works is when you look at the money on the books and what we spend, we've always looked at the whole number of what we spend. So in this case, if we're going to spend $20 billion. And we would be spending $20 billion that would include Medicaid, for instance. Well, sometimes we get money back and we get money reimbursed to us as a revenue stream from the federal government. And also taxes, everything else becomes revenue. What they did this time was they took anything with respect to Medicaid that we were going to get back. So let's say we were going to get, you know, $2 billion back from the federal government towards Medicaid. They took all that money off the books.
Wow.
What it did is it basically allowed them to compare their spending and spend more money this year. It was a total ruse and totally inappropriate.
Well, Dan, listen, we appreciate very much you fighting the good fight up there. I know it's a bit of an uphill battle, but thank you so much for calling us.
Anytime, guys.
All right, we'll see you soon. Get some rest. And get a part-time job, for God's sakes. You got to make some money. This thing isn't work. The pay-wise isn't working out.
I know. I gotta go find a good day job, right?
Exactly. All right. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Now, you know, we've talked a lot about you know, some of these issues from a more conservative point of view. The right or the left, of course, predictably through some of its outlets. And by the way, go Hawks. Puck's about to drop. But the left has responded this way, claiming racism, of course, is always the last refuge of a scoundrel. So let's see what the response is as we go to that videotape, and then we'll wrap up. Before we go to the videotape, let me just mention the Chicago Blackhawks are in the playoffs, and they're going to beat the LA Kings. If you know the score, don't tell me. We're about to go to Pippa's. But if we have that video lined up, let's go to that.
Despite the complete lack of any evidence linking the president to the targeting of Tea Party groups, Republicans are using it as their latest weapon in the war against the black man in the White House.
Someone needs to be prosecuted.
Thank you, Senator. And that goes all the way to the White House.
This is arrogance. This is big government cronyism.
Do you have any evidence that the President of the United States directed what you call a culture of intimidation at the IRS to target political opponents?
I don't think we know what the facts are.
But that hasn't stopped you from accusing.
There isn't a weekend that hasn't gone by that someone says to me, why aren't you impeaching the president?
This strategy is nothing new, and it was explained way back in 1981 by Lee Atwater, who was Bush 41's chief strategist. In a tape recording, Mr. Atwater revealed how Republicans evolve their language to achieve the same purpose. He said, you start out in 1954 by saying N-word, N-word, N-word. By 1968, you can't say N-word. That hurts you, backfires. So you say stuff like forced busing, states' rights, and all that stuff, and you're getting so abstract. Now you're talking about cutting taxes. We want to cut this is much more abstract than even the busing thing, and of a hell of a lot more abstract than N-word, N-word. So this afternoon, we welcome the latest phrase in the lexicon of Republican attacks on this president, the IRS. Three letters that sound so innocent, but we know what you mean.
Yeah, yeah, right. Yeah, it's racism. Yeah, okay. Jeez, I wish I could say some things, but we're on television. It's a bunch of malarkey. Chris, lightning round, say something really smart, really fast.
This government is trying to intimidate us.
Okay.
Last week we had Larry on the show, and he said that when posed the question, we said, can you name one thing where you would pull the plug that this president could do where you would pull the plug and say, you got to get out of office? He couldn't name one thing that he would where he would pull the plug. So if you said, what if he was going through FBI files in the basement of the White House? Huh. They already did that. So what if he lied under oath? Oh, well, they already did that, too. There's nothing that these guys can do where the left is going to get upset. They're going to embrace them no matter what they do.
Watch for a House Select Committee on Benghazi and a special prosecutor on the IRS. If you see that happen, you know they'll get to the bottom of it. The whole thing's going to unravel. All the threads lead in there.
Yeah, I think as well. I mean, in that last video clip, they said, "Oh, you know, there's no tie-in. It's not political." And again, but when these guys come in front of Congress and they say, "Oh, well, who gave the order to target Tea Party organizations because of their political expression?" We don't know. But one thing we do know, it wasn't political. I mean, this is like if your 10-year-old kid would come up and say this stuff to you, you'd say, "You know, Johnny, it's not good to lie. You shouldn't do that." By the way, sometimes, occasionally, we are joined by Al Robinson. Al Robinson, Hat City Blog, Hat City Blog. Go check it out. You'll want to. Al did chime in on tonight. He texted me one word. One word he said, yawn. But then it goes on. Same old rant, same old guest, same old. You should like the wackos on the public access that go on week after week claiming that 9/11 is an inside job. So they're claiming we're talking about 9/11.
Great deflection.
Complete misinformation, spin, and guess, and that fall apart once challenged on their rants. Again, concluding with yawn.
Never proven wrong. Three years running.
Okay, there you go. Well, listen, thanks for contributing, and we'd love to have you come in because we don't stifle political expression. That's y'all's thing that y'all do. So thanks a lot for joining us. We'll see you next week on The Marty Heiser Show. Actually, it may be a rerun next week, which
is
tragic. What
do you get on The Marty Heiser Show?
You always get the truth. And then after that, we have author David West, followed by Les LaBelle, who has an anti-Sharia message that you won't want to miss. That's really heating up in England right now as well. So thank you for joining us. Thank you for putting up with my rant. It's a good thing for me to vent. I want to thank my guest, Chris Murray, of course, Dave Strait, and Bob MacGuffie, Tea Party Patriots, all. Thank you very much, and we'll see you next week on The Marty Heiser Show. Go Blackhawks.